She could do it. She was independent. She was strong. And she was. She was going to get her point across to the whole community that she could do this and she didn't need help from anybody else. And she, you know what? She didn't. But in a way, that might have been part of her downfall.
I remember her laugh.
I would, without hesitation, describe her as Lauren Bacall's younger, prettier sister. But Bette was even prettier than that.
She had a career the other moms didn't. And if she wanted to do something, she did.
She wore hand-me-downs, and yet she looked like a million bucks. She had a style. It was more than just physical beauty. She really was a pretty woman, but she was a nice woman. It's just, it was unbelievable. She was really nice.
This is my mother, Bette, and she lives in my mind's eye. This picture was taken in 1990. She was 44 years old. This is my mother 10 years later, in 2000, when she was arrested for drunk driving. She was 54. And this is my mother in 2007, when she was arrested again. She was 61. 5 months later, she died of alcoholism. As I've tried to come to terms with my mother's disease and death, I've wondered, what did alcohol do to her body, mind, and spirit? Why did she start drinking? Why didn't she stop? How typical was her story? And who was my mother, other than an alcoholic?
My husband and I were on our 10th anniversary. We were away overnight. We're taking a walk through this campus where we got married. And my phone rang. It said restricted number, and it was the police. They said, Sherri, and they had been in touch with me over the summer. Your mother's mail's piled up for a week, and the water company went over this morning to turn off her water for non-payment, and the plumber got sick. There was a really terrible smell, and we need to, does she still live there? I said, yeah. They said, is she home? I said, I don't know. And they said, we have to break in.
I told the lieutenant to expect deplorable conditions inside the house. My mother had not let anyone inside for more than 16 years, and there were signs of serious trouble. Over the summer, she had been summoned to housing court by the Board of Health for rotting food left on her front porch and foul-smelling waste dumped in her backyard.
I could tell just from how she smelled and how the house smelled that this was a bad situation, you know, and I didn't know what was ahead. And I felt so badly for her, and I just wanted to do what I could, but she wouldn't, you know, she was just so ashamed.
The police had already prepared for the worst. They knew my mother is a chronic alcoholic and a recluse, and were aware of her citations from the Board of Health. The lieutenant said he'd call back to let me know what the officers found. While I waited, I thought about the past. After a 4-year estrangement from me, Mom had called back in April. She had been arrested on driving-related charges and asked me to take her to court. We had remained in contact since then, but on her terms. She made and answered calls when she felt like it. Sometimes weeks passed between conversations. Although it was obvious to everyone that my mother badly needed help, she refused to accept it. She was mentally oriented, so no one could impose help upon her. She had the legal right to live or to die as she chose.
I don't remember ever running into her. Never at the store, or the grocery store. Never seeing her on the street. Not at your grandmother's funeral. No place.
But she didn't want me to help her. So even though there were people that would have been able to help or would have wanted to, she had a hard time accepting that. I just feel bad that she had isolated herself at the end.
We all watched helplessly, ready and eager to reach out, if only she would let us.
And then when they called and said, yeah, you know, she's gone, and when's the last time you talked to her? And I said, well, 9 days ago. And they said, well, she must have died around that time. I just felt so awful that she was dead, and I couldn't even tell she was dead, you know? I just thought I'd be able to feel it.
There were more shocks to come. Her body was so badly decomposed that it had to be taken to the medical examiner's office in Boston for forensic identification.
Did she have tattoos? Did she have any screws or plates in her body that would show up on X-ray? Was she missing any organs? Oh, don't bother filling that out. There's not enough left for us to tell what organs she has and doesn't.
Dental records were not conclusive because she had lost many teeth since she had last seen a dentist. Finally, the medical examiner located an X-ray that showed a spinal fracture, and it matched an X-ray taken of her remains. Her body was positively identified and released for cremation.
And she wanted to die. She said to me, I'll be so relieved when it's all over. And she did die.